Jacob, going for a drive.
T22 Mazda MX-30.
GT without launch control.
It's electric.
That's pretty slow.
Horsepower torque.
143 horsepower, 200 pound-feet of torque from a 35.5 kilowatt hour battery and one electric motor because this is a front-wheel drive vehicle.
And with 70% battery, let's see if I can chirp the tires by turning right.
Great success.
So this being Mazda's first electric car, what's the competition?
So this would be like a Nissan Leaf, a Hyundai Kona EV, a Tesla Model 3 sort of, a little bit pricier.
Maybe Model Y because the hatch?
Yeah, again, price a little bit. What else we got? We got a Chevy Bolt. We have a Hyundai Ioniq 5, which we saw in person but weren't able to drive. And I think that's pretty much it. There's probably a couple others that I'm forgetting. And if you're shopping for a brand new Mazda, click the True Car link in the top right corner or the link in the description below.
Yeah, open it in a new tab, come back, watch our video, and then go to that tab after.
Boop.
And this is ballpark 50 grand Canadian.
Yeah, that's a lot of money because this is the top trim. And all of those all have a larger range than this.
Yeah, well, I guess what's the range of this one?
Okay, 161 kilometers. That is the rated range. And that is not very good for a brand new electric car in 2021 as a 2022 model.
But fully charged up, it showed about 200 kilometers. So I'm sure if you do some good eco driving, you could probably squeak a little bit more out of there.
Right, but this is also a brand new car. Like, we only have 200 kilometers on it. So I don't even think it's had like a full charge cycle. So the battery might not be calibrated fully yet. So we don't really know the actual range because we've had this for such a short amount of time.
The reason Mazda said this has such a low range is because they're aiming this at people who just drive it around the city, go home and charge overnight. They're like, 90% of people who drive this will be able to charge it overnight, and you don't need the extra weight of a larger battery for most normal stuff.
And I believe that because as an electric car, like, this is more of an urban car, and Mazda does say that. So they're not expecting you to do long distances in this. You can, but you just have to know what your charging infrastructure is like where you live.
And one of the weird things about it is even though it's a five-seater, it's a suicide door, four-door kind of thing, just like the Honda Element, just like the Raptor.
Yes, exactly. So coach doors, whatever they call them, basically they open backwards.
Yeah, so you can't get out of the back unless someone opens the front door, which means you couldn't drive this as an Uber.
Yeah.
And I think because of that, this is totally designed for young people who do not have kids, because now that we have kids and used our Raptor and Element for that stuff, suicide doors totally suck for that stuff.
Yeah, not so good.
So there are a couple things that I don't like about this Mazda. But I want to start with the things I do like, mostly the looks.
Yeah, the looks are fantastic. I think this is one of the best looking cars in this class.
Starting with the front end, they really made it look like a robot almost, like the way it's so chiseled at the front and with those cool headlights.
Yeah, and it's still Mazda from the front, but different enough that you know something's up.
Yeah, but it's got the same headlight issue where you can't have the cool rings on while you're driving and all that lame stuff.
Yeah, Mazda thing, don't worry.
If you pop the hood, there is a ton of room there, and the reasoning behind that, instead of putting storage, that they said was because it's a scalable thing and they want to put different things in, they don't want to commit to like a storage thing.
I think it's a poor excuse for not having a storage thing in there. But, I mean, you can see all the electric motors, so people complain. We complain about having plastic covers everywhere. This doesn't have any, so there's that.
It is very cool to see it like that.
Yeah, it is.
And then from the side view, we don't have the cool swoop.
No, it's just like regular body lines, nothing crazy here.
And an insane amount of plastic cladding, but it kind of works, especially in this grayish metallic-y color.
Yes, and I fully agree because we complained about the plastic cladding on all their other models, but it, for some reason it works here.
They know, they're good at it.
Yeah, and then we also have the floating roof sort of thing. We have a two-tone thing.
Yeah, the two-tone roof is cool. I like how it's darker on this. And then we've got that little bar where it says electric in front of it and then Mazda. I think that is a very, very nice touch.
I think the Mazda is a nice touch, but the fact that the electric is just a sticker on the window is not a nice touch.
Yeah, when you get like close, it's kind of like, eh.
Yeah.
Wheel-wise, it's not too electric-y, I think just a nice, solid design.
Yeah, Mazda wheels are always like nice and clean, nothing too crazy.
And what would be the Continental recommended tire for a MX-30?
The Cross Contact LX-25.
And it took me a second there because I keep thinking MX-CX. This is based off a CX-30 platform, but they're using MX, which is MX-5 like a Miata, but this isn't really a Miata.
No, this is nothing like a Miata. So it's very confusing to say the name and think of what it actually is.
Yeah, and it's got the weird suicide doors like an RX-8, but it's not manual and rotary and like crazy because like they had to put those suicide doors on there just so that they could get it built. So it's like a whole weird thing.
It is.
And then the next cool part of the looks, the taillights.
Yeah, the taillights are awesome. The way that they stick out of the body.
It's just like a full-on cylinder. It looks really cool. We got a nice circle design and everything.
I think these are my favorite Mazda taillights.
I would agree.
Yeah, because they actually like light up as circles. And then the funny thing is when you do have the turn signal on, it looks like the LED is trying to mimic a regular traditional incandescent bulb. It's kind of funny how they did that, but it's also kind of cool.
With like a little bit of a glow to it or something?
There's like a delay. It's like, because an LED would be like on, off, on, off. This is like on, slightly on, off.
And then the rest of the back, lots of plastic cladding, a hatchback. It is not powered.
No.
But when we do fold down the seats, there is a whole bunch of room there. And there's like a good amount of room with the seats up too.
Yeah, and even though the hatch isn't powered, they actually have a lock button up there, which is super convenient.
Yeah, because the Carnival didn't have that, and it was just like weird stuff that I didn't like.
And then at the back, we don't have any fake exhaust tips. They didn't try to trick anyone, so that's nice. Let's take a listen. Just kidding, there's nothing from the outside.
But we can listen to the electric sounds from the outside.
And what about the electric sounds from the inside? I like it.
Unoffensive, don't hate it, no issues. I think it's your turn to get behind the wheel, and then we'll talk about the rest of the stuff and end.
Launch control.
With the stuff we don't like.
Let's try a brake boost and see what happens.
It's okay.
It's okay. Okay, so we do have paddles on this, and I want to try to go to one pedal driving-ish. So I'm going to go max regen. I wouldn't quite call it one pedal, but you can control the regen, which is really
it'll
nice.
It'll really slow you down. You can use this to come almost to a full stop at intersections, but it won't let you go to a full stop.
Let's see. No, I
can feel
it.
And then use your brakes. But there's no weird brake transition from the regen to the pedal because it's all brake by wire.
Yeah, so the system that they did for this car is actually really good. Nothing feels weird, which we complain about in electric cars and hybrids a lot.
Yeah, they definitely killed it with that part.
And I really like having these paddles to actually control regen because sometimes you just want to be able to coast and then you just want to control it. So sometimes if you see your battery is low and you just want more regen, you have the ability to control that. So I like that Mazda actually gave people the choice of that.
Yeah, our favorite thing with electric cars isn't the crazy acceleration of them.
It's
hyper-miling the cheaper ones.
Yes, that is our favorite part, but our second favorite part is definitely launch control in electric cars.
You get sick of it.
Exactly.
You got sick of it too. You were I've had enough of this. That's what I'm saying. Hyper-miling is the cool electric thing to do.
Yes. So now let's address this power delivery. It's definitely adequate. It's nice that it's like, you know, instant, but it's not instant as in like a Tesla or anything like that. It feels quite slow.
It's not painful. It's just enough.
Barely. I would say barely, especially as a 2021. Like right now, if they released this 5 years ago, I'd be like, I understand.
I'm pretty sure the definition of barely is just enough.
Yeah, but it's like barely just enough is what I'm saying. It's like I borderline, this needs more power.
And then how about comfort?
Suspension wise?
Hit me with it.
Okay, suspension wise, it's quite good. It feels really well damped. Mazda's never really screwed that up. It is slightly on the sportier side, but I would say it's more comfortable than all of their gas models that I remember driving.
And then how about handling?
We haven't really handled this car too much.
Take this left turn.
Okay, here we go. Let's accelerate into the turn, use this electric G-Vectoring Plus, and ooh. Okay, the tires are squealing, but you can feel that it's doing something with all the electric motors going on.
Yeah, they're pretty good at like programming stuff to do all that stuff for you, but it's not something you'll drive sportily. They've got the Miata for that.
Yeah, and there's a ton of body roll, which you kind of expect in something like this. But the battery is actually located below us, which is nice to help with the center of gravity. And the steering also feels really nice. Again, Mazda never screws that up, and it's nice that it translated to their electric car.
Well, the Volkswagen Taos felt a little better steering-wise and everything than the CX-5 did when we compared those.
Yeah, which was odd.
Which was weird. Sometimes maybe Mazda doesn't nail it, but since it's the CX-30 platform, nothing off that has been bad.
But it's not like they screwed it up. It was just...
we expected more.
Exactly. And you said comfort generally before, so let's talk about seat comfort, because it is so comfortable in here. These seats are so well cushioned, and I hate Mazda seats because they're always way too firm for me. These are great.
Yeah, very nicely padded, and the design on them is very cool. So this is the two-toned option, which is on the top trim, the brown and gray. It looks really, really good. All the materials in here are actually awesome. It's got a whole bunch of recyclable stuff because that's the way that all electric cars kind of have to be.
Yeah, so you can see it up here, and it kind of reminds me of the BMW, was it the i3 or whatever, that had a bunch of crazy textures. We also have cork in here, yes, which I've never seen in a vehicle, which is very different.
It's cool, and they said it's kind of a throwback because Mazda started in 1920 as a cork-making company.
Very interesting.
So like, yo, throwback!
Yeah, so...
Or I think their marketing was, it shows that as we evolved from a cork company to a car company, now we can evolve again to electric and bring back the heritage of corks.
So they're going back to a cork company after this.
Maybe there's just a deal on corks.
Yeah, maybe. So we do have it on the door handles, which I feel like is the weirdest part. All the other stuff I'm kind of okay with. We even have it on the cup holders, which also go up and down as a cork thing. Very weird.
Okay, let's talk about the ergonomics and layout of stuff. We've got the normal Mazda infotainment. It's nice. We've got the rotary wheel and everything. We've got this weird sensor, which I don't know what it is, maybe a camera or something.
Yeah, it looks like there's something watching me right now. I'm not really sure what's going on.
We'll figure that out when Mazda emails us back. Our shifter's kind of weird. It goes right and then down instead of just a normal straight back shifter.
And Mazda has like a really nice regular shifter.
Yeah, kind of weird. But then we've got our climate control as a screen in front of that instead of the hard buttons that usually go there, which I don't like. I don't care about screens. I think this is stupid.
Yeah. So now we're in the section of stuff we don't like about this car.
Yeah, pretty much. Ergonomics and some weird stuff.
So here's the thing. Mazda has repeatedly told us that they're all about your eye level. You got to be up here. They do this screen so you can't touch it because it's not a touch screen so that you're not distracted. And then they put this screen down here, make it a touch screen to control your climate.
Yeah, just to jump on the electric trends. But I mean, it's nice because there are hard buttons, so like that's easy. But we also have this floating design center console area, which is just an electric-y car thing. And I kind of hate it because of the way the cup holders are and the armrest. So you can slide your armrest forward, nice, but
very
then you can't get to your cup.
Right.
So you slide this back and then you can get to your cup. But to grab the cup, it's back there. So you need to grab it from the top so that it risks lids falling off. And then you can fold these down and put stuff there instead. But where would you put your phone, Jacob?
So, well, if you had a cup, you couldn't put your phone anywhere, really.
But there's this whole area here that's meant for your phone so you don't mess with it while you're driving.
Right. And then your USB plugs are also down there, which is really hard to get to because you basically have to get out of the car and reach underneath to plug it in and just leave it plugged in all the time.
Yeah, but that's the kind of thing Mazda is. They want you to like get in there, put your stuff away, and concentrate on driving.
Yeah, and you really have to in this car.
And then another cool thing with the infotainment and everything, you know how a lot of electric cars have the gauges that tell you how far you can go and everything?
Yes.
We have to go through our infotainment to information, and then we can click on the high voltage battery monitor, and then we can see our charge driving range and driving range. If we turn off our climate, we'll get an extra 2 kilometers. This is cool, but I can't program it to this favorite button below the volume knob.
Yeah, so that would have been nice to have that. The good part is that you do actually have your battery percentage in your gauge cluster and your actual distance at all times. And they even have an analog full and empty gauge, which I really do like.
But how about charging and range and everything?
Okay, so the range does suck. The charging times are okay because it's a small battery. It's like level 3 around 36 minutes, which is, you know, pretty reasonable.
And it's cool that they show you the estimated AC charge time, because I feel like this is kind of a low commitment electric car that you don't need a level 2 for this because it's such a low mileage kind of car anyways.
Pretty much. Like, you can actually charge this overnight.
And that's what I did. The cord was in the back. It was like long enough. The charging port is about the back right. Overall, it was very easy to use.
Yeah, and like I said, these gauges are also really nice. Their analog gauges and their digitalness did translate well to this because it still looks like traditional Mazda in here for the most part.
Yeah, and then it's got all like the safety sensing stuff that all Mazdas usually have.
So what about lane keep?
No.
Exactly.
It doesn't have that kind of stuff. But Mazda, they don't have a good lane keep kind of thing yet.
But for electric, you kind of expect it.
But it's Mazda.
Yeah, I know.
They don't care about that.
Did you say Mazda or did you say Mazda?
Oh, I don't even know.
Got them!
But they even said, they're in the presentation, they're like, we don't think we're going to sell many of these. We kind of just wanted to do it because we wanted to do it. And it's like...
That's an interesting take, Mazda.
And they're like, look, that's what we do with the Miata and people like that. So we kind of do what we want. And you're like, okay, just don't stop making the Miata.
Yeah.
Whatever. Sure. Yeah. Okay, cool, cool.
Do whatever with the MX-30. Make sure the MX-5 lives on.
Okay, how about backseat room?
It's actually okay if I'm sitting behind you, but sitting behind me at 6'1.5", not so good.
Yeah, there's like a surprising amount of room back there.
And it's cool that we actually have a power button on the back of the driver's seat, so you can actually just move it forward and back from there.
And we got a little sunroof here, which is nice.
Yeah.
But like, Mazdas never have a full panoramic sunroof.
Right, exactly.
It's not their style.
Yeah.
Okay, other cool things. We've got Apple CarPlay, Android Auto. It works pretty well. We've got Ryanic satellite radio stations, TuneMix, and we've got pretty high quality 360 cameras with hard buttons on the left to control that, and a traction control button on the left as well.
So overall, I mean, this is a pretty good car. the things that suck aren't really deal breakers unless you travel outside of the city, especially for the range.
You know what the competitors are for this?
What's that?
ID4.
Oh.
And like, think about how much these guys did right.
But that's huge compared to this. Maybe the ID3, which we don't have.
Yeah. Wow.
No.
But think about that interior compared to this interior.
Even though it's not a direct competitor, interior layout wise, this crushes the ID4.
Because this actually works.
Yes.
So I feel like that covers everything we need to cover with this. Oh, vibe.
Except the sun. We got to cover the sun, Yuri.
3, 2, 1.
Ah.
Fail.
Extension.
Yeah.
That doesn't count.
So before we get to the price, if you're looking for a new Mazda, click the TrueCar link in the top right corner.
For discounted price offers.
So hit me with the price.
This one is exactly $49,950 with this optional two-tone interior.
Kind of expensive.
Very expensive for the range, for the horsepower, for the, what you get.
But it is a weird semi-luxury brand, and they're not going to sell too many, so it's kind of just like a fun experiment for them. Let us know what you think about the new Mazda MX-30. Leave a comment below. Would you take this over the competition?
Is it too little, too late, or is it just right for right now?